hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul,
try that again. Good morning. Apologies. Happy Resurrection Sunday to you all. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Yes, he has. One announcement this morning, I believe, and that is just the reminder of our Wednesday night bridge course, where we get together to continue growing in our knowledge of Jesus Christ, being further equipped to take the good news of Jesus. And because we serve a resurrected Savior, I would encourage you to come Wednesday night, invite a friend, continue growing in being equipped in serving Jesus in our community. Would you stand with me this morning? And for our call to worship, we have a couple of slides. I will read the yellow portion, which is the verse. Together, we will read the white. So let's call one another to worship this morning. Mark 16, 5 and 6. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him." Hallelujah. Isaiah 25:8, "He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken." Death is swallowed up in victory. O death,
where is your victory? O death, where is your sting?
Isaiah 42:16, "And I will lead the blind in a way that they do not know. In paths that they have not known, I will guide them. I will turn the darkness before them into light, the rough places into level ground. These are the things I do, and I do not forsake them." Darkness has been vanquished.
The darkness is gone. Brilliant light.
1 Peter 1, 8 and 9, "Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Come, let us worship God
and celebrate his good news."
Yes.
Hallelujah. Christ is
risen. Last one, 1 Peter 1:3. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy. He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Christ is risen in our hearts and our spirits. Christ is risen from the dead. Hallelujah. Amen." Lord, we rejoice in you. We are eternally grateful for your substitutionary death. Thank you for taking our place on the cross. Thank you for bearing our shame. Thank you, Lord, for emptying the cup of the Father's wrath. Thank you for resurrecting. Thank you for new life and hope and all that is ours, because you defeated death on our behalf. You defeated sin, the hell, and hell and the grave. And we are, Lord, just amazed and humbled at your grace toward us, because we know that you sit at the right hand of the Father with all authority given to you. We pray, Lord, that you would resurrect the dead today. Those caught in trespasses in sin, make them alive together with you in Christ Jesus. Lord, help us who have hoped in you to rejoice all the more and be strengthened all the more in all that you have done, that we would live in the reality and in the power of Christ resurrected. That today, I pray, Holy Spirit, you would open up our eyes and see the glorious Christ as he is, lifted up, worthy of all praise and glory and power and dominion forevermore. We pray this in your name. Amen. 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 Church family, let's welcome one another this morning.
Save me, buried and carried. Romans 6, verses 3 through 5. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Amen. How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living Lord. Who could imagine so great a what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to bear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has
everybody sing. Amen. He is risen. Happy Resurrection Sunday, everyone. We assemble again to celebrate our death-defying Savior in all his victory and all our victory in him. In fact, we gather every Sunday that we gather precisely because Jesus rose, and he rose on a Sunday morning, and so that's why every time we get together on Sunday, that's why. He's why. His resurrection, the fact that we sing to serve, preach a living Savior. We don't come to memorialize. We don't come to look back. We come to point the world to a living Savior. And so that's what we do every Sunday. But this Sunday, we join with saints all over the world who are looking to Jesus and his resurrection in particular. And you'll come here next Sunday, and we'll still be singing about it. We'll still be preaching and praying about you. You probably won't see the preacher in a tie, but we'll be preaching the same Jesus. And we're taking a short break from our sermon series through the Gospel according to the Apostle John today, again, to celebrate with the rest of the Christian world the resurrection of Jesus. And again, while we always sing and teach about our risen Savior, we're blessed because we're going to get to circle back, I'm guessing October, November, as the book of John comes and takes us right back to Jesus Christ, his death on the cross, and his resurrection. We're double dipping this year. We're going to have Easter a whole lot, and so we're looking forward to that, and it's a blessed hope that we celebrate, and hope is very much at the heart of the passage that will occupy us today. And so I'm going to ask you to please break bread with me to Luke's Gospel account this week, a favorite and familiar passage, the 24th chapter of Luke, and we're going to begin reading at verse 13. The reading will be healthy and robust and meaty today, and if you feel for whatever reason you can't stand through it, you're welcome to sit. Just keep your heart standing in reverence to the living, inerrant, infallible, inspired Word of God, which reads this way, beginning at verse 13 of Luke 24. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you're holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it's now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, "Oh, foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is God's word. Would you pray with me? Lord, we pray, what we do not know, teach us. What we do not have, give us. What we think we know, let it be measured up against the truth of your word. And what is not of you, we give up, that we might hold to truth and behold you as you are, living, victorious, active and present among us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you. There's told a story about a man walking through a park who happened upon a Little League baseball game. And curious, he walked over and he saw a young boy sitting in the dugout. And he asked the young boy, "How's the game going?" "We're down 18-0, replied the little boy. The man reckoned, "Wow, you must be discouraged." "Why?" retorted the player. "It's only the first inning and we haven't even gotten up to bat yet." We might be amused by this and mildly moved by this plucky young man who never giving up despite all the odds and the fact that his team is woefully overmatched, he holds on. All indications that this is a blowout. This can only end one way. If this were a movie, we might expect that over the next 8-plus innings, his team might claw back, get them to a tied score, and at the last moment, two outs, bottom of the ninth, full count, the smallest player on the team gets up and swings the swing of a lifetime and sends the ball over to the cheers, the applause, even the tears of the crowd in the theater. We all love an against all odds underdog kind of story. We love to see hope flicker and live in the darkness of hopeless situations. And for this reason, the story of the Little League ball player that we just recounted here would be a terrible illustration for the passage that we just read and would have exactly nothing to do with the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. Nothing. It's not remotely the same. The resurrection of Jesus was never a come from behind tale. The resurrection of Jesus from the dead was not a plot twist or a surprise ending to the story, not at all. Everyone should have seen it coming. Everyone should have staked their eternity on it and anticipated it with all joy and hope. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is not a surprise. What we have in our passage today is what happens when, despite the clear teaching of Scripture, our hopes are misshapen, our hopes are misplaced, and then hope just dies. But what we also have in our passage today is the unchanging reality that Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, is the object and reason for our true and sure hope, a hope that is alive as he is. Luke sets the time and the place and the characters for us in verses 13 through 15. The timestamp is, and I quote, "that very day." Verses 1 through 12 told us what day that is. It was the very day when the women found the empty tomb. It was the very day when the angels asked them why they sought the living among the dead. It was the very day that they ran back and reported their experience to the rest of the disciples, only to be greeted with disbelief. It was that very day that Peter and John ran to the tomb to find it open and empty. It was that day. That's the day that all of this is taking place. And the place where this is happening is on a road that led from Jerusalem to Emmaus. Luke concludes the fact that it's a 7 dusty mile trip. And the true life characters were, first, two people. Two travelers. One is named Cleopas. The other remains unnamed. Some scholars have wondered, were these two men? Was it a father's son? Were they friends making the journey back from the Passover? Others have thought that perhaps it was a married couple. It very well could be. The language doesn't preclude that. It may have been a married couple walking down that road to Emmaus that day. The truth is that in either case, there is a particular sadness to that pair. Verse 13 refers to them as two of them. That is, two of them. That is, two of those who had known Jesus, had sat under his teaching, had followed him for some amount of time. It was two of them who had heard his teaching and seen his mighty works. And what is sad is that in that friendship, or even in that marriage, if it was a man and a woman, there was between them no encouragement. It's really sad. Two who had seen him, heard him, could not muster between them encouragement. It would seem that in a friendship, and especially in a marriage, that at least one party, when the other is discouraged, would offer up the encouragement and restore true hope. You could count on one when the other is down. That's the whole idea of coming together. But it's so sad when there's no hope even between the two. We come to see that they both shared the same errors, and therefore they both shared the same hopelessness. But Luke introduces one more person to the party, one more traveler to the journey and to the conversation, one who quickly becomes the center of the dialogue, as he is the center of everything, the center of all scripture, the center of all history. Luke emphasizes his arrival in verse 15 this way. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Jesus himself, formerly dead, now alive forevermore, he personally did not dispatch an angel, a prophet, or an apostle. Jesus himself. Between the tomb and an awaiting throne in glory at the right hand of majesty, to the singing and praises of myriads of angels, between the tomb and all that awaited him, he paused to walk with two sullen travelers. What kind of savior is this? He postpones his glory to draw near to and walk and talk with those who had lost hope. Because that's who he is. That's who Jesus forever is. And that's how Jesus loves. And while Luke makes the third person in this traveling party known to us as the risen Christ, he also lets us know in verse 16 that while the reader knows it and Luke came to know it, the two other travelers did not. Verse 16 says, their eyes were kept from recognizing him. For the sake of what Jesus was about to teach them, a miraculous appearance would serve them best later in the lesson, not now. It's here where the conversation begins. All guided by the pair's new friend and traveling companion, Jesus asked them about the topic of their conversation. I see you walking, I see you talking, I see you just really lost in the conversation, and I'm just going to inquire, what is it you're talking about so intently? And when he asked the question and invited himself into the conversation and asked them to begin to recite to him what it was they were saying and why it was they were saying it the way they were saying it, it touched a nerve, just as he intended. And Cleopas and his partner opened the floodgates of their hearts to him. Verse 17 tells us, at first they stood still, looking sad. So heavy was the topic that they couldn't walk and recount it to him at the same time for the sadness of their hearts. They had to stop, and it was a sad sight. And what came out of verse 18 erupted with a sharp edge that is so common when you ask someone, even today, to recount a recollection of a painful event in their life. And they say it with a passion, and they say it with a certain edge to it, just kind of with a hint of resentment for you making them relive it, even to a degree. And so they answer Jesus that way. Then one of them, named Cleopas, verse 18 says, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" There's an edge to it, make no mistake. Where have you been? How could you possibly not know this? How are you going to make me answer that question when it hurts so badly? And instead of Jesus making himself known at that moment and asking, "Who do you think you are? And how dare you speak to the risen King of glory that way?" Jesus humbly draws him out. What things? What things? Jesus lovingly inquires. And what ensues is then an inventory, layer after layer of circumstances and reasons that caused hope to die in the hearts of these two. I mean, it's a sincere and it's a very insightful statement that's made in verse 21 when they say, "But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." We had hoped. Maybe that even had a grain of sweetness to it. Ah, oh, do you remember when we had hope? Do you remember when it was good? Do you remember when we were excited? Do you remember when the future was bright? Do you remember when we could face today and tomorrow just because we had this hope in him? We had hoped. But now they speak of that hope only in the past tense, the way we speak about a deceased relative. The pain of their disappointment lay just beneath the surface, and Jesus' question just open the floodgates. In their estimation, the reason for the death of their hope, the reasons, multiple reasons, they were substantial, and they were ever present on their mind, and they had a ready answer and a ready list to give to Jesus as to why they were speaking the way they were speaking. First, they told Jesus of Nazareth about Jesus of Nazareth. Not knowing it was him, they said, "Oh, there is a reason for our sadness and the sadness in our conversation." They told him about one who came who was a prophet and who did such great things. They said, "There was one among us," again in the past tense. And they weren't able to see Jesus as ever having been more than a prophet. But they wanted to let their new friend know that they were justified in having gotten their hopes up in the first place. Jesus was amazing. He was so loving. He spoke with an authority that the religious leaders could never approach. He did things that only the Son of God, we thought, could have done. Jesus led us to hope. But Jesus, they went on, let him know, was crucified, condemned and crucified at the whim of our religious leaders. That's a two-edged sword. They said that with two kinds of pain mixed together. There was a confusion about the religious leaders. These are the men that we follow. These are the men that were allegedly steeped in the truth of the Gospels, and they set themselves now as enemies to the compassionate prophet that dwelt among us. And it was confusing to them. Sin in people that we respect wants to strike at our hope. We trusted them and we loved him and they came against him, and now, worse still, they were successful in their hatred. We saw him as having all power and all dominion and all glory. We suspected he might be the one. And then tell me, what kind of a prophet, what kind of a redeemer was Jesus if men could kill him? What a letdown. They go on presenting the reasons for their despondency. "Furthermore," they said, "moreover, it's now 3 long days since all of this took place, and with every day, hope was just fading." I mean, the first day we thought, well, maybe he's not really dead. Maybe he's just badly injured and he'll recover. There was superstition among the Jews that the soul of the deceased dwelt around the body for several days. Maybe that second day he would come back. But after 3 days, even in their own superstition, there was no hope. Now, either they didn't hear Jesus' promise, specific promise to rise again in 3 days, or they just didn't believe it, having heard it. But 3 days of silence proved too long of a delay for their hopes to endure, and hope died. The fact that Jesus was still gone and the Romans were still in power didn't match their expectations for him, and hope was gone. You see, when our timing, our timetables, our expectations don't match up with the surrounding realities, when our desires are not met by God how and when we want them met, so often we want to lose hope. And their list of reason for discouragement continues. Now, with the shocking claims of others, verses 22 through 24, they tell of the experiences of those who'd seen the empty tomb and heard even angels speak, they said. And moreover, as though it's bad news, moreover, they said, there were women who went and saw an empty tomb, and they heard from angels. And Peter and John went and found the tomb as empty as the women did. They're testimonies of other people's experiences brought them anything but comfort. See, when we hear of other people's experiences of God, they aren't enough all by themselves to keep our hope alive, and sometimes they only cause in us a greater despondency as we see them in their satisfaction and we with a growing discouragement. We had hoped, they confessed. Their hope was dead. And having patiently allowed them, the two of them, to make the case for their hopelessness, Jesus waits till they've got it all out of their system, and he responds. And now, against what most handbooks on modern counseling methods would teach us, Jesus opens with these words. Oh, foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. Again, most modern counseling manuals would require you to first affirm all of their feelings. To tell the hopeless that their perceived reality is their reality. You go on. You live out your truth. I'll join you in empathy. And I won't question you. If that's your reality, that's your reality. Or some such drivel. But Jesus loves too much for that. Jesus could not stand to have them spend that blessed day or any subsequent day under that dark cloud. And Jesus teaches them a lesson that would sustain them and their joy for the rest of their days. He teaches them to hold to God's word for their sure hope. Now, I say that, and some of you hearken back to a time when you, in the very throes of a trial, you, in the heart of a storm, with no other hope, no other plan, B, C, D, or E, all you had was the word of God, and you found out for yourself, experientially, doesn't matter what the preacher said, you found out for yourself that God's word is enough. It's anchor enough. It's hiding place enough. It's truth enough. When all else tells you to the contrary, you found that out. And Jesus wants them to know that as well. And some of you might be saying, I don't know what you're talking about. Then you are most blessed today because you are going to be geared up for when the storm comes. Not if, when. When hope wants to die. And Jesus makes clear to them that nothing else will do but all of the Scripture. It's a foolishness to do otherwise, and he tells them so. You are foolish to have tried to stake your hopes on anything else. You are foolish to have tried to find your encouragement anywhere else. Now, foolishness is not a lack of intelligence. Foolishness is a moral failure. It's not that the intelligent people know the Word of God. It's just the wise ones that do. Foolishness is to think that one's own thoughts and opinions can be trusted more than God's. When you spend more time mulling over what you think, what you muse, what you calculate, what you reckon to be a possibility out of your pain, when you think that is a better direction than to turn to the living Word of God, that is a foolish, foolish path. Some would say that the last thing this pair needed was a Bible study at that moment. You don't do that. They're hurting, man. Don't get all preachy on them. Jesus begs to differ. Oh, foolish ones. He holds them accountable for the truth they'd been exposed to. There was nothing in their list of reasons for their hopelessness that the Word of God could not make sense of and not make hope of. I mean, think about the things that they said were their reasons for their despondency. They would have known from Moses and every other prophet, implicitly and explicitly, that Jesus had to suffer at the hands of Jews and Gentiles. To fulfill all prophecy and all righteousness, he had to die. He had to rise again on the third day. It couldn't have been any other way. And they should have known that from the unchanging Word of God. The traumatic events, the actions of government around them, the timing of the occurrences, the testimony of other people around them, all seen in the light of Scripture, would have come together not to discourage them, but they would have just proven and bolstered their hope as they saw God's Word coming to life around them. I mean, think about it. Think about what their complaints are. Let me tell you how bad it was, they informed Jesus. It was so bad that Jesus died. Yeah. It was so bad that the Jews and the Romans conspired and died. Not just died, they crucified him. Can you believe that? When all the while, in their scrolls, in their Psalms, in Psalm 22, his Isaiah 53, are all the passages that say it couldn't have happened any other way. They should have known it from the Word. They should have been dancing in Jerusalem and not walking to Emmaus. What was the difference? What was the missing element? What's the difference between hope and hopelessness, a knowledge of, and a faith in the unchanging, unerring Word of God? Saints, it makes all the difference. You've weathered too many dark nights in hopelessness as your Bible sat there dusty and calling to you. The living Christ on every page calling you to hope and joy. Our hope has always been founded upon the Scriptures, God's eternal, unfailing promises. Listen to how Paul reminds the Corinthian church. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain, for I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. He says the gospel we preach is not shocking. It's always been foretold to be this way. The gospel that we preach, the gospel that we hold to, the gospel by which we are saved and being saved and kept until the end, it is one foretold. It is a promise made and kept. And we are to know our God that way, as a promise-keeping God, so that hope can stay alive. Those earliest believers trusted God's sovereignty. They prayed and hoped according to the word. If you get a chance, get home and read Acts chapter 4 and how the saints, regular rank and file saints, not clergy, not seminarians, regular saints cried out to God, the sovereign God, and said, "We know that your son, Jesus Christ, was crucified in accordance with the scriptures, according to all that you had predestined to take place." They knew that the God they served was sovereign and that he made his will made known to us. He made it known to us in Scripture. Oh, that we could rejoice in that. Without the truth of Scripture, we can build those false hopes that are so painfully dashed on the rocks of real life. In those hopes we place in all kinds of other places, things that we do not derive from Scripture or that do not align with the Scriptures at all. If I just get that job, if I just get that girlfriend, if I just get that promotion, if I just lose those pounds, oh, it's going to change everything. And behind you, there's a trail of broken, shattered hopes. Isn't it time for a hope that will never fail? Isn't it time for a rock-solid assurance in your soul that says, "Come what may, let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, I am standing on the rock of God's word"? Oh, you could use some of that. Your marriage could use some of that. Your finances, your parenting, your work all week long could use some of that. It would take the desperation out of our lives. It would have us no longer making ethical shortcuts in the way we live, trying to bless ourselves instead of standing on the promises of God found only in his word. Luke 24:21, "But we had hope that he was the one to redeem Israel." Now, among other things, this is an issue of definition. The words all sound right. We had hoped that he would be the one to redeem Israel. He was. Then why are they so smashed? Why are they so heartbroken? It's because it's an issue of definition. All the words sound right, but they mean them differently. When they spoke of Jesus coming to redeem Israel, they weren't speaking of the redemption that he came to bring. It was the one that they had made up in their own minds. Biblical hope is not a dreamy fantasy of our own making. When we speak of hope, it's not like, "I hope this scratcher gives me what I'm looking for." It's not like, "I hope this slot machine hits it finally." No, that's fantasy, dreaming, wishing upon a star. That's Disney, not Jesus. Again, I got to tell you, I walk around probably a little angrier, a little more often than I should. I was walking through a store, and there it was again, those general, nonspecific, very vague kind of decorations that are just so popular. And there's this huge wooden plank that whole look that is all the rage right now. And it has emblazoned on it, "Hope." I like hope. I'm all for hope. I need hope. I'd rather see that than some other words on a plank. And I'm looking at that. Yes, this is good. Hope, but hope in what? You're encouraging everyone to hope in every direction. There's got to be some more planks around you. There's got to be some context to this. There's got to be hope that is settled and anchored in one that is true and worthy of our hope, or somebody's going to get hurt. Not just a general kind of wishfulness. It's a hope. Why hope? In whom? For what? That's not the hope of Scripture. That's not how God calls us to hope. That's not who Jesus is to us. Hope is something else altogether. Hope in Scripture is the sure anticipation of God's promises in God's word, in God's time, proving to be true according to God's faithfulness. It's a sure thing. We don't hope as we're rolling dice. We have a sure hope based on the promises that God has made to us in his word. Hope's not defined by our earthly wants, but by Christ's heavenly treasures reserved for us. It's not up to us. There was, and I've mentioned her from time to time. She comes to mind from time to time in passages like this. There was a woman who sat amongst some of you, perhaps, and she was here for some time, and she came to me and said to me very matter-of-factly, very properly, and I appreciated the sincerity through all the tragedy of what she said, but she came and told me one day, well, this is going to be my last Sunday. I'm going to be leaving now. Thanks for everything. We won't be coming back. And I said, why? Have we offended? Is there falsehood in our doctrine? Is there so? And she says, no, it's just that I tried it. I came, I checked it out, even got involved a little bit. I even told you I believed and I let you all baptize me. I told you I agreed with your statement of faith, all these things, but I'm leaving now because the truth is this. And she looked around to make sure nobody was close enough to hear. She said, I was hoping to lose some weight and I didn't. And so now I'm leaving. I had hoped it would help give me some self-discipline, a little structure to my life. And it didn't work. And I'm leaving now. Nowhere in God's word, nowhere from this pulpit, nowhere amongst the sheep was there ever preached to her the right to have that hope. And her heartbrokenness was all of her own making. Jesus didn't live and die and rise again to custom tailor for us our little tiny sinful versions of salvation. She was not concerned about the life to come, eternity. She was not concerned about the forever status of her soul in relation to God. She was not concerned about those things. She had this one immediate, temporal, earthy kind of salvation in mind, and her hope was let down. Jesus didn't come to tailor-make your salvation. Jesus came for his glory through the rescuing of sinners from the coming judgment, a judgment we'd earned. That's why Jesus came. And these men said, we had hope that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And the redemption that they spoke of was not the redemption that Jesus came to bring. They thought that he would come and he would save them, rescue them from Roman oppression, save them, rescue them from a downturned economy, save them and rescue them from the shame amongst all the other nations for having been kept under the thumb of the Roman Empire. They wanted all kinds of other things that they determined were redemption, and Jesus came for a different kind of redemption altogether. Jesus died and rose to redeem the souls of men and women, Jews and Gentiles. Jesus came to save sinners from judgment and give them eternal life. This is our blessed and sure hope. It's an issue of definition, but it's also an issue of authority, really. Our hope is authored by God. He is the source. He defines whom we are to place our hopes upon and what we are to hope for as Jesus took these mopey, hopeless, sad travelers to task, and he says to them, it is a foolish, foolish thing you do. I'm trying to make another Savior and another salvation out of the one who God sent. After making plain to them the authority of Scripture, the faithfulness of God, the sure hope of God's promises kept, they arrive to Emmaus. And it's there that Jesus now offers these men the opportunity, as he offers us this morning, the opportunity to act upon our faith in his word and a newly budding hope. Verse 28 says that Jesus acted as though he would go further. Well, gentlemen, we've arrived to Emmaus. It's been good. It's been a wonderful Bible study. It's been my joy, my pleasure to open to you all of Scripture and show you how they all pointed to Christ, his life, his death, his resurrection. I have just thoroughly enjoyed this. Now, gentlemen, I bid you adieu. I'm going to be making my way to somewhere else. And they said, no. The men asked him to stay. They weren't glad to see the preachy stranger leave. They didn't want his words, God's words, to walk away. And to leverage their desire to keep this blessed stranger in their midst, they told him, "It's getting dark now. It's late in the day, and it's not proper for you to travel any further." It was the practice in that day to stop all traveling as the sun set because it just wasn't safe to walk around at night. Jesus agreed to stay as he'd always planned. And once inside and at the table, Jesus, mind you, still unknown to them, is a curious thing. He takes over the hosting duties. It's not his house. And he grabs the bread and starts breaking it and handing it out. He just took control. And before they could take any offense at his forwardness, Jesus opens their eyes to recognize him just as he vanishes out of their sight. And Luke tells us of this pair's reaction to that revelation and disappearance of Jesus at their table, and how it led them to an understanding and a life and an energy that they had not formerly known. Listen to how they understood it all, how they processed the whole episode. Verse 32, they said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" Notice what they didn't say. "Did not our hearts burn within us when we finally saw him risen?" You notice how they didn't say, "Man, did you see that when he appeared with the bread in his hands? That's all I needed for hope." That's not what made their hearts burn. That was exactly God's plan in keeping himself concealed from them. Jesus would not let them know who he was because he wanted them to place all their hope in his eternal word. That they would not need some miraculous, bombastic display for them to have hope, but just the never-changing, all-powerful word of God in their lives. "Did not our hearts burn within us as we walked along the way and he spoke to us from the scriptures?" Who makes your heart warm? What are you looking for? People have traveled far and wide. I heard there's miracles here. I hear there's a wonder there. I hear they're handing out holy water there and special oil there. And all the while, there is the word of God. "Did not our hearts burn within us when the scriptures got a hold of us? Wasn't that enough? Didn't hope revive? Wasn't tomorrow bright again when the word was open to us? Oh, it's wonderful. I'm glad we saw him. I knew it, but I know in his word that he lives whether I saw him or not." Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? They didn't primarily rejoice for having seen him. They joyously recalled what the word did in their hearts. That's why Jesus didn't make himself known. Find your hope. Find that steady, enduring, unchanging hope in the steady, enduring, unchanging word of God. See the difference that a right and a living hope brings? See the change in these men. Remember, these are two sad figures walking down a dusty road just a couple hours earlier. And now listen to them. These are the same men who told Jesus, "Don't go out. It's getting dark. We've just traveled 7 miles. The day is done. Just stay with us. It's not safe to travel anymore." Verse 33. "And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon.' And they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread." Did you hear it? What they once counted as a too dangerous, too long kind of a trip. It wasn't the right time. Wasn't the right circumstances. It's not safe to go out after dark. And now it says that same hour, they made the 7 mile track back to Jerusalem. What used to be dark and dangerous and not advisable, suddenly when there's hope, there's courage. When there's hope, there's a reason, there's an energy, there's a fire about it. Doesn't look at circumstances, goes back. Everything changed now. What they thought was impossible, what they thought was ill-advised, suddenly everything is different. The second 7 miles, the trip back, there was a different pace in their step. There was a different conversation between them. They were going to gather with different kind of people. Everything was different. Their plans for the next morning undoubtedly had changed. Nothing would be the same as a biblical hope in a risen Christ enters your heart and causes it to burn brightly, brightly enough to affect those around you. And friends, the hope that Jesus gives, the hope that Jesus is simply too big for this life alone. It's too big. It doesn't fit. It inevitably spills over into eternity. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15:19, if in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. Paul says that the kind of hope that you have in Jesus is only to get you over your sicknesses and help you pay your bills and help you mend your marriage. He says you serve a small Christ and you are to be pitied, because the hope that Jesus gives is bigger than this life. Trusting and hoping in the risen Savior brings far more than joy to this brief existence. Because Paul again writes to Titus these words: for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. It's a hope that's too big for this life. It bleeds over into the next. Those same scriptures that tell us of Jesus' resurrection, they tell us that he will appear again to make all things new and right for those who have trusted him. Not just those who had a pretty good attendance record, who were friendly with their parents' church. No. Trusting in him includes the reality and the implications of his resurrection now and forevermore. So that Paul could write to the Romans and say this: because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Believe in him that way. Come, lived, died, rose, the risen Son of God. Place all your hope and your trust in him, and nothing will ever be the same. No matter how many false hopes have broken your heart, you can place yourself and your eternity securely in the hands of Jesus, our risen and living hope. Pray with me. Come in all your glory. Make our hearts burn. Leave no room for lesser hopes, no space for those things that we have put our confidence in. Only you, and you, as you've made yourself known in Scripture, help us to know you that way. Heal us from the heartbreak of false hopes that have come up so short. Help us to respond in faith and to live in hope, to trust your word, to follow your leading. Help us, Jesus, to stand firmly upon your promises, to be not ignorant of the glories of your word, to be not rebellious toward what we know. Make us a people hopeful above all other things, known for not our wealth, not our influence, but the undying hope that governs us. Because you live, We have hope. Sure, steady, unchanging, firm, secure hope. I pray by your Spirit right now, speak to that person who came so smiley, so smartly dressed today, but whose hope has worn thin because it's been set elsewhere. It's been set in a relationship that failed. It's been set on money that flew away. Hope that was set upon youth or health that fade or change in a moment. Hope that was placed on past accomplishments or future aspirations. All of those will break our hearts so surely. That our hearts burn. The hope that comes from your word. Speak to us today by your Spirit, we pray. All of our hope in him. Let's stand together and let's celebrate him and how in his living, loving grace he's supplied all of our needs. with some of the ministry needs and opportunities that we have before us these days, it's never been more important than for us to be faithful and generous in our giving to God, that others might know the hope of Jesus Christ locally and around the world. We have some tremendous opportunities to be a blessing that way, and through our giving, amongst other ways, we can do that. But let's go before the Lord in our offertory prayer and just give him everything. We thank you for the opportunity to come and to sing, to pray, to read, to gather, to smile, to hear your word. None of it's deserved. All of it's a blessing. And you let us take part. You dwell in the presence of angels, in the perfect service of archangels, and yet you incline your ear to hear our prayers, our songs. We do love you, and we praise you, and we lift up all of these things, all that's taken place today, Lord, as an offering, acknowledging you are not in any way obligated, but also from your word, acknowledging that you are pleased when we offer up to you what we do in Jesus' name, including, Lord, our returning to you that which we have first received from you. Lord, I pray today that everyone who gives, whether it be online, automatically, in person, however it is they go about it, Lord, but that it just be done in the way that you love, cheerfully. Not equal gifts, but equal sacrifice and equal gratitude, Lord, because you have been good to every one of us, giving us all the same blessed salvation. And so, with that in mind, in great joy, with a song on our lips, Lord, we give to you all these things, and we do it in Jesus' name. Amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into
Thank you for being with us this morning. It only made it sweeter. If anybody would like to speak about anything regarding Jesus, any question you have regarding who he is and what salvation means, we'd love to talk to you. Pastor Ramon and I would be happy to spend some time with you or set up a time to get together. This matters more than anything else. More than anything else, make sure that you stand right with the coming living Savior. And so with that, we'll be dismissed with the benediction, the blessing found in Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Go in the grace of the Lord. Tell somebody about the risen Savior.